Hello, everyone. I don't know if you can. Okay. Is it okay? I guess it's okay. Yeah, it's on. Yes. Hello, everyone. My name is Irida, and I am a PhD student in the electronics department. I'm here to talk about more or less the energy efficiency in wireless vision sensor networks with a focus on smart cameras. To begin with, we all rely on visual inspection as one of the main ways to get information, one of the key inputs in our everyday life to get information about our surroundings, about events, and so on. And vision systems have been developed nonetheless to support us and to enhance our capabilities towards vision and also even replace human vision. Looking back at vision systems, they have evolved significantly, starting from old systems that consisted mainly of a set of cameras connected to one another and to monitors or storage units, because they had high costs relying on staff in order to do a visual inspection of what was being screened in the monitors, and also it required significantly high memory capabilities, which at the time was not only costly, but also was quite bulky in area. Hence, smart cameras were introduced, which consisted nowadays in the camera node having the imaging sensor and processing capabilities embedded in the same node. This helped a lot in the development of vision sensors, and with the development of the Internet of Things that started shaping all the industrial and technological development, the requirements towards vision sensor networks have changed. Nowadays, we have scenarios such as environmental monitoring or smart cities that require a more facilitated deployment. And instead of the previous scenarios that we used to have back a few decades ago that consisted mainly of indoor monitoring, nowadays we are looking towards highly optimized systems that do outdoor monitoring for every type of conditions. The main issue in these cases becomes deployment, and not always it's possible to have a power plug present in the different deployment scenarios. Hence, we need to evaluate, we need to design battery operating device, smart camera nodes, which can handle not only the computation, but also can provide the same good performance as the current systems while providing a long battery life to allow the system to be independent. My focus is mainly on the energy efficiency of the smart camera node, and through the research, we have stopped in different points, and we began with the sensor selection. Common vision sensor networks consist on visual imaging sensor, which relies on the reflected illumination or the reflected light from the objects and captures that light, and then the images are produced. Instead, we thought on using thermographic imagery, which relies on the temperature profile. It captures long wave infrared radiations from objects with temperature above absolute zero, and then overcomes one of the main difficulties of visual systems, which is illumination changes. If we consider outdoor scenarios, they will be exposed to different weather situations, to different illuminations, and also we need a system to be robust throughout the day-night changes as well. And with thermographic imagery, we can overcome all these illumination complexities, which gives us the idea that maybe we can optimize the previous image processing algorithms in order to have them more low weight to facilitate the implementation on embedded smart cameras. Another point that is pro the use of thermographic imagery is the fact that it allows to have privacy. It preserves the privacy of the people despite large-scale applications such as smart cities, which would require the deployment of the cameras in a city scenario with all public spaces being exposed. And it would be it would have otherwise a high impact, high social impact. And the last two points of why thermographic imagery would be the choice is memory and computational requirements. As I mentioned before, smart cameras consist of an embedded processing device inside the camera node. And of course, in order to facilitate the deployment, we want the camera node to have a low volume, so we don't want a very bulky architecture. This comes at a cost, of course, in terms of memory and computation. And current algorithms are highly expensive in terms of both computation and memory requirements. If we just stop at background modeling algorithms, due to the high complexity of illumination changes and to overcome that complexity, we have highly sophisticated algorithms like Gaussian mixture model, k-nearest neighbors, and mixture of Gaussian that can provide a good performance, as we see, depending on how many history frames and how much computational requirements we give to them. So, for example, if we compare the results between low-pass IIR filter, which would be our approach, and the Gaussian mixture model and the mixture of Gaussian 2, the difference is quite significant. The Gaussian mixture model uses significantly less history frames, and then for the mixture of Gaussian 2, we use more history frames. However, the performance using a low-pass IIR filter is better. And that comes because we firstly evaluated the temperature changes of the environment, and we modeled that using a low-pass IIR filter. These temperature changes in the background through the day were much less abrupt than the illumination changes for which these algorithms were designed. So this not only improved our using the low-pass IIR filter, not only reduced the computational and memory requirements, but also improved significantly the performance of background modeling. However, we need to consider that the computational requirements of towards smart cameras are quite extensive. If we stop and think about tracking algorithms, detection algorithms, and so on, not always is possible to implement these algorithms and to implement the whole image processing chain in a single embedded device. Hence, we need to consider another host processor, which in some cases is a server, cloud, or maybe even the fog. In the problem of defining the energy efficiency of the smart camera node, we need to consider all the elements that are present in a smart camera. Research until now focuses mainly either only on the processing part, or only in the communication part, analyzing both of each of these issues separately. Instead, in our work, we introduced a term intelligence partitioning, which refers to nothing else but the distribution of the image processing task between the different computational elements, and then estimates the overall node energy consumption, taking in consideration the embedded hardware, energy consumption, the embedded software, and also the communication part of the energy consumption. As I was mentioning before, the main approaches towards energy efficiency in the smart camera nodes are by taking each of the elements separately. So if they start analyzing into focusing only in the processing energy, they consider how transferring the image processing tasks from the smart camera node towards the cloud affects the processing energy. And that is all they do. Or in the communication energy, how this affects if we pass the processing from the cloud towards the smart camera node. Our goal is to define which would be the point where both of these would be optimized and we achieve the overall smart camera node energy efficiency. And for this, we developed a people counting scenario. And we considered three processing elements, which are embedded hardware, embedded software, and the cloud. And we considered also three different groups of communication technologies to analyze, which are the local area network, the cellular technologies, and IoT technologies. Each of them has been developed with different characteristics and different data rates and delays, which are very important for the vision sensor network, because we need a real-time performance, we need energy efficiency as well. Here are displayed all the combinations of the intelligence partitioning, where we have also considered data reduction techniques such as grayscale and binary image compression, and also data aggregation. So in this plot, we can see we are tackling the issues regarding data rate and regarding the data size to be transferred and the delay. The reason why we are considering data size is because, for example, in cellular communication technologies, we cannot use data continuously. We don't have unlimited resources, because that would result in high subscription costs, which as well inflicts in the end in the cost of the smart camera itself. So as we can see, putting a threshold of just 10 gigabytes per month, most of the communication, most of the configurations cannot be supported, which is the upper part, because the data rate requirements for a smart camera scenario are much higher than what could be. Instead, considering the delay issue, we consider the frame rate of the smart camera, which would be 10 frame per second. The frame rate of the smart camera, which is 10 frame per second, and from that we estimate a general delay of 0.1 second. And from this as well, we see that many of the configurations are left outside. So in the end, we are left with very limited options, which rely in all the implementation for cellular technology to be focused in the smart camera instead of being transferred. And this is as well for the same plot, but now done for IoT communications, where we can see that the delay is a major problem for most of them, where technologies such as LoRa and NB-IoT have very reduced scenarios where they can function, only those two, and that is because of the high delays that they inflict, which makes difficult to meet the real-time performance required from the system. Furthermore, in many systems, they consider image compression and take it by default the fact that implementing image compression, due to the fact that it will reduce the communication workload, will optimize the overall smart camera energy consumption. And from our analysis, it proves not true. For the case of software implementation of binary image compression, for example, where it actually results in an overall increment of the energy consumption of the smart camera node instead of reducing it, due to the trade-off between communication energy consumption and processing energy consumption. So the amount that we saved from the communication, it's much lower compared to the compared to the processing energy consumption. And the same issue is as well for grayscale image compression. In conclusion, we have here we have all the scenarios of all the different configurations with the different communication technologies and the results of the energy consumption for each. And we can see that the best performance it's achieved when we have implemented in the smart camera node until morphology. So we do part of the image processing in the smart camera node until we have a binary image, and then the data is compressed and transferred further to the server for the more sophisticated processing, such as detection, tracking, and so on. the best performance is achieved mainly with Bluetooth low energy 5 and also Bluetooth low energy 4. Instead, technologies such as LoRa and BIoT, most of the IoT technologies are limited to only the scenarios where all of the implementation is done inside the camera node instead of being transferred. The results of this work motivate us to investigate much further about the addition of more processing layers between the smart camera node and the server host processor, and fog computing seems promising to be investigated how it will affect the actual energy efficiency of the smart camera node. And of course, our model needs to be extended further on with the addition of more nodes and to increase the complexity. Thank you.
Great. Do we have any question to Irida? I was wondering just quickly about this. You said in the beginning when you were talking about choosing visual camera sensor or
thermography, yeah.
Camera, yeah. You said that one of the benefits of going to a thermal camera would be the that one gets rid of the light interference, you could say. How in outdoor scenarios, how would you be affected by, for example, sunlight?
In outdoor scenarios, you have much more complexities actually towards illumination challenges, because, for example, if we consider our scenario where we are surveilling on a road, just the cars passing by and the reflection from different objects can cause an abrupt illumination that can cause false detections. And instead, with thermography, you have you do a profiling of you continuously model the background. So only when an element with a higher temperature, you do the absolute difference. So as long as an element that has a temperature different from the background, then you can detect it and you can process further on.
Great, thank you. Any other questions? No? Then thank you, Irida.
Thank you.